Thanks everybody for coming. It's great that you could come, and we'll just give our panelists a second to get situated. They don't have a microphone, do they? Maybe I should give it to them and then pass it around.
Yes.
Is that okay, folks? All right. I spend all the time in front of a microphone myself, so we're gonna go alphabetically. And Peter, you're gonna start with you. So thanks everybody for coming. What we're going to do is have the panelists introduce themselves briefly. We'll get the thumbnail sketch of you and your what your involvement is. And then we'll get down into some of the issues that we have, some questions that we have prepared for them, and some questions that you're going to pose to them as well. And hopefully we'll have time to get it all in. We hope to have you out by 11, as promised, so we'll see. My name's Steve Plampkin. I'm with WPRO Radio. I'm a reporter, anchor, host, and they've asked me back because a couple of years ago they did a series on Tech Collective's own first initial survey into the IT needs and asked me to host that, and it was great fun, and I'm back for more fun today, just like
you are. Awesome.
Thanks. So let's start with you, and we'll get you to introduce each other, yourselves briefly with a thumbnail sketch.
Sure. Good morning, everyone. My name is Peter Moreau. I'm the CIO at Amica Mutual Insurance Company. We're based right here in Rhode Island, out of Lincoln. I've been with the company pretty much my whole life. So I was a Marine grad back in the day and went right to Amica, and I've been there my whole career. So I've been the CIO there for about 5 years. I grew up in Rhode Island, so this means a lot to me. I grew up in Cumberland, Rhode Island. So it's really important that we build up our talent. Entry-level hiring is something we do pretty extensively, so be happy to share it with everyone.
All right, great.
Good morning. My name is Chris Shoemaker. I'm the CTO of Mojo Tech. For any of you who don't know, Mojo Tech is a software development consultancy and agency here, headquartered here in Rhode Island. One of my chief roles is hiring. So the talent of our workforce is really the lifeblood of our company as a consultancy. But I also interact with a lot of our clients. Almost all of our clients are building products and then eventually go on or are immediately trying to hire their own employees. So we also kind of consult in that aspect as well. I am sympathetic with them and their troubles about hiring as well.
Chris, excuse me, Chris, is there a better name than Mojo Tech? Come on. Okay.
I don't think there is.
Hi, I'm Joan Peckham. I'm Chair of Computer Science and Statistics at the University of Rhode Island, and I'm a computer scientist myself. I'm also co-coordinator of the Big Data Initiative at the University of Rhode Island. We're about to propose a data science program. And I was a program director of education and workforce development at the National Science Foundation for 3 years, 2008 to 2011, where I was very excited to be on the ground floor to help with this national and international definition of computational thinking. So you can imagine my excitement about what's happening in Rhode Island right now. Really great.
My name is Tony Rucco. I'm the Computer Science Program Coordinator for Roger Williams University. I've been at Roger Williams since about 2002, but I've been teaching in the computer science field for about 25 to 30 years now. I also, in addition to working predominantly at the undergraduate level, I also work with computer science program accreditation at a national level. So we do look at computer science programs from California through Connecticut. And one of my primary interests here is how do I get students into my program who are qualified to complete my program in a timely manner? And then how do I get my students who graduate to go on into meaningful, and for me, what I would hope to be a lifelong career in a field of their choosing? Thank you.
All right, great. So Tony, you've got the microphone in your hand, so we're going to start with the first question directed toward the folks in academia. How does your department determine core skills in the classes to offer?
Okay, one of the things we look at is, we're obviously a university, we're an undergraduate focused university. So when I'm looking at how to develop my computer science program, I go to two sources initially. The ACM, which is one of the largest computer science organizations, and then the IEEE, which comes in from the electrical engineering side. They give us a lot of what they consider to be the core skills that a computer science undergraduate degree would entail. We talk to our graduates when they graduate and they get their jobs. It's like, okay, what was our program missing? What would we have given you that we think you could have done better with? We talk to our employers as well as what we're missing and what we need. But also, we also have to respond to university requirements. We are accredited bachelor's degree. We do have obligations in humanities, science, and arts as well through a general education program. So we can't just say for 120 credit hours, we'll do nothing but computer science, because we do have those liberal arts requirements as well. So again, we're looking at the university requirements, professional societies, and then feedback from our graduates and their employers.
Joan, you want to tackle that?
Sure, and all of the above. I mean, I have a list here, and pretty much he covered all of those things. But we also are working extensively with K through 12 in the governor's computer science for Rhode Island program, and looking at how we scaffold and how we greet students from K through 12, provide feedback to K through 12, and the preparation for the skills that are needed. So that's, you know, one other domain. And we also look to our international partners. There is emerging this whole idea of computational thinking. What are the critical problem-solving skills that students need? And there is coming to be some agreement on that. And then there's this new area of data science. I just went to a national meeting where scholars from all around the country were thinking about what are the critical problem-solving skills, what should a student know how to do when they leave the university with a degree in data science. And of course, the next thing that I think these scholars need to do is talk to industry. I think it would be very important for us to hear what are the skills that are needed. So,
all right.
Consistent with the public that they
do. All right. Chris, what's missing from your entry-level IT employees?
Well, I guess I could talk about some certain technical things, skills that I find missing. But I think that one of the parts of this report that's really valuable and that I really resonated with was that emphasis about these workforce readiness skills. And I think that, you know, when 89% of the employers cite as the most important workforce competency is problem solving, critical thinking, it's necessary to look at that and say, you know, maybe that's actually the problem. I think it's certainly the problem for what I'm trying to hire for, and what I see as a key deficiency. And, you know, we kind of have to sort of draw the inference. Like, if employers are having so much trouble hiring, and this is their, you know, the most important criteria, then we have to say this is not a solved problem. And it's too easy to, I think, brush aside and say, oh yeah, problem solving, critical thinking, yeah, everybody learns that, and everybody can do that. And this is not true. And it's not just at the entry level, this is even at the mid-level. You know, I interview folks with 5 years experience that I still think they can't think clearly. And IT especially, and kind of what I do in our business is software development, so application development, that category, it's absolutely critical. The medium is so unconstrained that if you cannot think clearly about what you're doing, you will soon lose yourself. And this is a fundamental skill, and it's too easy to say, oh yeah, just everybody learns that, when they don't. This, I think, a big piece of it is about information management. So, you know, can you take a clear stock of what you know and what you don't know? Can you form hypotheses about what you don't know in order to perhaps learn more about them? Do you recognize when you're making logical inferences? Can you distinguish those between deductions? Can you form an argument? right? Can you form a logical argument where it follows logically, your conclusion follows from the antecedent? A lot of the people I'm hiring, even or trying to hire and looking to interview, can't do this. And it's something that's very difficult to screen for as well, which makes it risky to hire, because if somebody can't do that, it's very difficult to teach them how.
Say it's a shortcoming in analytical thinking or in expressing themselves?
It is. The two are related. Usually, if someone doesn't think clearly, they will not be able to speak clearly. The second most important one is, you know, ability to communicate with coworkers. I think that's a big piece of it. In the context of technology, communicating effectively often means thinking clearly first and then expressing that. We have folks that are not particularly strong communicators, and does that limit their career potential? Perhaps in some degree, but if they can think clearly and they can interact with the computer, say programming, they're going to be a productive member of our team and be successful.
You want to point any fingers?
No.
Peter, you find this as well?
Sure. I'm going to focus a little bit more. Definitely, as the survey pointed out, problem solving and those types of skills are definitely something that continually needs to be enhanced through the educational process. But the communication piece is really important. The students coming in, our new hires coming in, have done some work with projects and whatnot through the schools, but that's a critical piece of our technology stack today. The way we develop applications, it's very, it's with an agile methodology. And in the agile methodology, work side by side with not just your coworkers on building out a project. You're working with business people who are co-located within your with you building that application. Now you're talking communication skills are critical, because now the actual developers are working side by side with a business person who doesn't understand technology, doesn't understand a lot of these things, and they have to work on things and deliver them on a short-term basis, 2-week, month basis. Those are critical skills that need to be continued to enhance. So I'm encouraged by what Joe was reporting, about we need to get more of that into the educational process as
well. All right. Well, while you're passing that microphone on down to Joan, let's turn back to the academic side. Would your department be willing to find ways to include more workforce readiness skills if it meant less depth in technical areas?
Absolutely. And I can say that it's something that we have been doing for quite a while. Based on input at least a decade ago, a survey of employers said exactly the same thing. That was the time in which we started requiring writing and communications courses in our major. We have a social issues and computing course that students are required to take. But I just had a long conversation with someone by email in Charlotte, North Carolina. He's a high up in Bank of America. And we were talking exactly about this, these workforce readiness skills, and going back and forth as industry and academia do. I can tell you that the most important thing for us is the critical problem solving skills. It's something we've always worked on. There was a time in which industry tried to coerce us into teaching the hot skills of the day. Why haven't they had 5 years of programming in this particular environment, this particular language, and so on? Happily, my conversations with industry today are more, we need more of the critical problem-solving skills, and we're very happy to work on the work for its readiness skills. But I think what Joe was talking about earlier, it really takes a community. This is not something that the university can do by themselves. These skills need to begin to be trained in K-12. We will continue to work on that, and we solicit input from industry all the time, figure out how to strengthen it without weakening the critical problem solving skills, which you pointed out are very related to the second item. And also, I would like to urge industry to think about their responsibility, which Joe talked about a little bit also, in taking and helping to train the new employees. Yeah, they'll probably leave you after a certain number of years, but then you're going to hire someone that another company has trained in these skills. So it's really a patchwork quilt of effort, and communities. I just want to put one last plug in for our new general education program at the University of Rhode Island. This is going to be very helpful to us and to you because it's an integrative general education program. The students are required to have courses in which they work on real projects. All of the courses are integrative. It's not standalone, a little bit of math, a little bit of science, a little bit of arts, and so on. So I think this is not only going to be helpful for the students, give them more exciting courses, Grand Challenge courses, for example, are required. It is also going to help to prepare them with these critical thinking skills and workforce readiness skills that I think that, you know, maybe sometimes computer scientists are not the best to do exactly all of that. Our colleagues in the other disciplines can help us with that.
As you pass that over to Tony, I'm just curious because I was wondering, as I was looking at the list of recommendations, the last recommendation was the Industry Advisory Committee. No commitment here, but just by a show of hands, who'd be interested in serving on something like that? Just, there'd be a lot of people interested in tackling something like that. Twice a year, it's not so tough. Tony.
Okay, when I read this, it says including more workforce readiness skills, if it meant less depth in technical areas. I don't think there actually needs to be a trade-off there. I come out of an engineering background, and one of the goals of problem solving is to solve the problem. And if solving the problem requires you to be able to communicate, then communicating becomes part of that technical skill. If you need to give a presentation, presentations become part of that technical skill. So what we did is when we look at our program, I look at this bullet list, and other than some of the business models, we do a lot of it already at Roger Williams. We start programming in terms of projects freshman year. They give presentations freshman year. Now, obviously, there's a difference between a freshman level presentation where you're really happy that they can get PowerPoint that's not black letters on a brown background. And then you move up to senior level presentations where they're actually trying to sell their project to a client. So we do incorporate that throughout our 4 years. We have our senior design process is a 2-semester effort where we bring in a client from the outside, and it's up to the student team to develop their requirements, develop their timeline, determine what constitutes a successful project, and then they turn that over to the client at the end of the year. Or at the end of our academic year. So in that process, they learn communication skills, they deal with the client who's changing requirements. So again, it's not a trade-off, it's more in terms of linking them together. Now, one thing that is a problem for us in academia is when industry comes up to us and says, we absolutely, positively must have graduates who know Ruby, which is a programming language. I've been teaching for 25 years. I can give you 30 languages that are an absolute disservice to our students by not teaching them. So when industry tells me you must know Ruby, I interpret that as we have to teach object-oriented programming paradigms. So what we also would like industry to do is recognize that our students come in and they may not know a specific language, but they can solve the problem and have the ability to learn that language far quicker than if you look for somebody who is so specialized that every time their job changes, they are learning something completely brand new from ground zero. So I think, again, it's not a trade-off of technical and readiness skills. It's being able to mirror them and match them together in a better way that we understand what the requirements of industry are, and industry kind of understands the capabilities of the university to provide those needs.
All right. So as we swing over back to our dynamic industry duo, do you want your entry-level IT employees to be an asset immediately or in 5 years?
Yeah, that would be immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, there's realistic expectations, I think, about what somebody that's just starting out in their career can do. They're an investment. I appreciated that part of the report saying it's not just interns. Interns, you kind of know what you're getting. For us, I mean, there's not a huge difference between an intern and somebody that's green straight out of college or just starting their career. That's an investment in a way. And so what you're trying to do is make good investments. And I'd say five years is way too long. So yeah, I mean, they're going to be becoming a valued contributor within hopefully months. There's the full recognition and acknowledgement that when I hire somebody that's at entry level, I'm going to be training them. I have dedicated people doing nothing but that, just training them. That's fine. I don't have the expectation that they will have experience with certain technologies. I guess I'd like that if I could find that, but it's not. I can't find that, so I'm fine with just training for the technologies. I'd much rather select people who have those workforce readiness skills, and that's what's going to make them a good investment. It's going to take you some time to train them in the specific technologies, but I think there might be. I think part of the confusion might be from a failure to make certain distinctions between certain kinds of jobs, and I think it's both employers and maybe in the academia and the training communities. There are different kinds of jobs, and they don't all have the same requirements. I guess that was one of the sections of the report. Some of the jobs really are about technology, and I could see an employer, if they've correctly identified their job is one of that type, saying, look, I just need somebody who knows this technology, this skill, because that is what they're going to be doing. And when the technology changes, that's right, they're going to need to learn new skills, right? But then there are other kinds of jobs where that doesn't matter as much, and the technology is going to be changing more quickly, and there are other things that are more fundamental. And I think both the employers would probably be better served in recognizing which kind of job do they have. That would help them make better selections. And then the students and people training them also need to make those distinctions too and say, what do I want to do? What am I going to be prepared for?
Peter, I'm guessing you can't make 5 years either.
Yeah, 5 years that was a loaded question. That's really not the case. And right immediately, entry level hires. We use technologies, many of the technologies that have been trained in the universities, but we also built our own web frameworks and different things on top of that. We use specialized software packages to deploy our insurance systems. They need to be educated on that as well. But what we look for is them to be able to, and we've built training programs that will bring them right through that. What we found, which is really a tribute to the universities that we work with and that we get students from, is that they get to be productive, almost what I'll call an FTE-like person on a project within a year. And that's pretty impressive, actually, when you look at the technologies that we're using and how complex that systems are. So it is working in the universities. I do agree with Tony's point, though, about it's not, you can't sacrifice that depth, because if you sacrifice the depth, you're really not going to get to that year, because we're going to have to train them basic programming skills or something else that they didn't get. So you have to have workforce readiness as well as the technical skills education going through that. So we've been very successful. We do quite a bit of entry-level hiring, and we measure that. And every student's different, and we do aptitude tests to make sure when they come in, believe it or not, there are college graduates out there that really don't have a CS degree that don't have the aptitude for it, so we screen those out. But for the most part, it's been very successful. We actually did an experiment, where we hired a couple of folks who really didn't have hardly any programming skill coming out of college. Had an IT degree, but really no skill to speak of. Maybe they did a Hello World application, but that was about it. But they had good workforce readiness skills, because they were a good communicator. They would culturally fit with our organization well, so we felt they had good aptitude. So we actually put them through the program, and they've progressed just a little bit longer than the others. So it is possible to leverage that, but prefer to have the technical skills as well as both. I mean, we want it all, right? So instead of the old one.
So back to our universities, and this goes to another one of the recommendations. Could your department increase the number of computer science or CIS minors to increase the number of tech-savvy graduates?
At Roger Williams, this is a big effort that we have ongoing. It's been ongoing for about 4 or 5 years now. We actually have, in addition to the computer science major, within my program, we have a 15-credit computer science program and an 18-credit computer science program. If a student completes the 18 credits, they get formally recognized with a computer science minor. If they do the 15-credit program, it gets annotated on their degree that they filled in something that we call a core concentration. Over time, and under President Farish, there's been a big push, especially for the students in the liberal arts, to also take one of the professional major or professional minors. So we are getting a lot of our students coming now from some business schools come in. We get a lot of the liberal arts, the English majors, history majors, coming in and taking our one of our two programs. So yeah, we have increased it. We're working to increase it. And right now, we probably have the same amount of minors as we do majors. So it's a big part of our program.
Yes, absolutely. And as you heard earlier, we're working with Lee Pichet to do that. We already do have a minor, but we hadn't advertised it heavily. And actually, the two minors that we're working on with Lee are devised with more industrial input as to what is needed. And it occurs to me that would satisfy or help you with these sorts of critical thinking employees with broader skills could also come in with enough technical skills to come up to speed and more quickly. So absolutely, we have a very large and convoluted spreadsheet for the president and provost to figure out what resources are needed, and we're aiming for that.
It's a state school after all, right?
Right. And one thing I should mention that's a really neat feature at URI is that students can declare their own minors. It's called a faculty-directed minor. All they need is a signature from one faculty member and the dean of the college. And that's probably how we're going to ramp up these two minors before we go through the long process of making them permanent at the institution. So.
All right. So as you pass that over to our industry folks, so how do you inspire more students to explore and enter IT careers other than by your mere living examples?
Yes, that's that. Well, you know, we probably don't really interact with many of them before they're sort of at our door. I think there's probably two aspects of that. There's a piece where it's actually kind of important that they're somewhat inspired before I meet them. If somebody has even the barest exposure to programming, and you know, they realize that, okay, they can tell the computer what to do, and the computer's gonna, if it can, it's gonna do exactly what they told it to do, and that they can apply that skill for any myriad of outcomes, whether it's amusement, or art, or helping people become more productive in business, or you know, cure diseases, or send people to the space, or whatever. If that lack of constraint, you know, lack of constraints in the medium itself doesn't inspire them, then they probably shouldn't be programming. But once they do have that level, I think, where industry can come in and really kind of shepherd these people through their careers is by, you know, having them cast their vision a little bit further out and say, okay, you know what you can do today, but look at how it can be a little bit easier. Look at how the boundaries of what is feasible for you with your current skill keep getting expanded, pushed out farther and farther because you can do this even better than you could yesterday, right? And here are some better tools. Like somebody who's driven to dig, you know, to mine, and all they've had is a shovel, and then they have a backhoe. It's like they, you know, they're thrilled with that, right? So that's the kind of inspiration that I think industry can provide, is just enabling them to do a good job and to do it better and better each day.
Peter, I'm guessing your best hires are the people who have a passion for it.
Absolutely. For those of us that have worked in IT, and I've done it for a long time, I mean, what really drives you is solving problems and then putting solutions in. That moment where you put a system in place and it works and it does the function that you were planning for and where your user community really likes it, that's what drives IT and people. But to inspire more people to go into the field, I think put a plug in for CS4RI. That's a great program that's really going to spark some interest and inspire people to go into the field. And I think for those of you that haven't gotten involved in it, you might want to take a look at this. It's an interesting program, especially long term, as was noted earlier about the state in terms of getting more feeders into our system, driving more students to the universities to get into the programs. I've told this story before, but I'll probably tell it again. Amiga is actually part of the CSR4RI program. It also gets our employees involved, so they're getting involved. They're going to help with the schools and do different things. So we're going to support that as an organization because it's going to help us to stay local with our jobs and kind of get feeders in. But my own story in terms of how I got interested in IT, it's many years ago, pretty old. When I was at Bryant, Bryant has an interesting, the way they organize their IT, their programs was you take 2 years of pretty much general classes all the way through before you really get to your major. And one of those classes was an IT program. I took that program and I was pretty much, I went in as an accounting major, which is pretty typical at Bryant. But as soon as I took the IT program, I was like hooked. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed what it was all about. And then I was like, I switched immediately and went into IT and graduated in IT. I think when students at the high school level and K through 12 level are exposed to what it can really do and how the iPad works or how the iPhone, how things are actually functioning, they're going to get enthused about it and then they're going to get inspired and want to go into the field. So it's an interesting STEM approach. I know some folks have met Andre earlier who does a lot of work in STEM. It sounds like I think this program is just is going to have that effect. I think it's going to be really interesting. I've seen a lot of them wrong that didn't really take hold, don't seem to drive as much. This one, I think, has got a lot of legs to it, so hopefully we'll see it materialize.
Well, this leads us to our bonus question, which is for everybody. You can all take it one by one. How do we create an ongoing communication feedback loop between Rhode Island business and CS and CIS programs?
Yeah, this is... There's really not a single solution to this because you have to approach it from a lot of different perspectives. One of the biggest approaches that we can do and keep on going is something like this report. And that's why I want to thank Joe for this because I'm writing my annual assessment of how our education at Roger Williams worked, how my computer science program does. And I've got 8 bullets that I can now say we do or we don't do. And I can use that to drive, changes that we make. But there's a lot of different ways to approach it. We have a professional advisory board for our CS program. They bring in information of what industry needs are. But there's other ways to do it. All the universities, they have projects. Submit a project, and you'll get to see what the students can actually do. It's almost like a free internship. So if you have a project that, a shoebox kind of thing that you would really, really like to do it if you had 4 people to put on it, well, a lot of the CS programs have 4 people that they can put on it. So you can give feedback to the schools that way. You can volunteer, or not volunteer, you can try to be an adjunct faculty member, again, to teach one section of a course just to see what it is that we do, what it is that our students can do. You can bring that. We have an adjunct faculty member now at Roger Williams who actually uses some of his work projects as sort of screenings for what students can and can't do in terms of what his company is looking for. So there are those kinds of things. The biggest way, obviously, is to have input is to hire our graduates. So if you start hiring our graduates, and tell us what's missing, that gives us a little bit more incentive to actually change as well. But again, it's academic. We can do an independent study in the time frame of a semester, but to build a program takes a little bit longer time, as Joan was referencing. I mean, there's things that are high speed, low speed, glacial speed, and academic speed. So you want to be able to kind of work with faculty members to kind of get into that higher speed mode rather than, say, create a formal program, which could take years once it goes through the academic rigors because of the requirements we have in terms of university accreditations.
see how long you can bypass the administration.
Right, basically.
John. So all of the above again, but also be sure to call the department chairs and ask how you can help, or if you have insights into what you think we should be doing. We have an advisory board for our department, so you could call up and perhaps volunteer for that. I also wanted to mention again that all of the after-school initiatives that are going on, many of them now are becoming mature and robust enough that they're looking at the K-12, K-20 actually educational systems and trying to see how they can link the learning objectives in these semi-structured environments to recruit and retain students and thereby provide feedback to the schools and the schools provide feedback into the program. So we have really a patchwork quilt of industry, after-school programs, formal programs, everything from kindergarten through PhD. You can enter and volunteer and be involved on any level. And I can tell you that those of us in the educational systems are listening. We want your input. So and perhaps we need to have some more events like this. You know, where we have these conversations. I think that could foster communication between industry and academia.
Yeah, those are all good suggestions. There's not just one answer. I guess I'll focus on the internship. I was kind of surprised in the results that there weren't more people taking advantage of the internship. And I guess it's partly because not all internships are created equal, I guess. You know, there's some students that maybe they're savvy enough to know that they actually need some real world experience, and they're just also looking to make some money during the summer, and so it's that kind of independent thing. We've had success in hiring people who are interns and then became full-time employees from various schools. I think what's worked best is when the internships were actually part of the formal educational program. That way, there's that connection. There's opportunity for interaction around what's working, what's not. What did they get out of it? What do you hope that the next person will get out of it? And refining that process. That's especially important because, you know, maybe it's different for, you know, we said 50% of those companies are larger than 100 employees and 50% were less. The bigger companies are probably looking more long-term, but those smaller companies, you know, they're running a business and, you know, we can't look 10 years down the line. We're just hoping to still be around, right? So we have to look at shorter time frames for that return on investment. And so an internship, that's probably a good time frame because you're thinking, okay, here's somebody that's gonna start, they're gonna work for 3 months, whatever. Maybe they haven't graduated yet because they're a rising, you know, a senior. Okay, but next year, I can wait 12 months. They're gonna come back, and if I have evaluated them, if they've done them well, at least I'll know what they can do. I vetted them, and then, you know, it's good for them because then they're, you know, maybe looking for a job. That's the kind of time frame that a small business can probably tolerate, and it's a good opportunity for keeping that discussion going.
Yeah, I echo a lot of what's been said. Yeah, we work a little bit with a few of the universities in an advisory role, if you will, of looking at curriculums and that type of thing. Others we work with, career office, we can probably set that up a little bit with more of the universities in the area. Because I do like the overall submitting your presentation on, you know, submitting our requirements in terms of
what
techhire.org. Yeah, I'm assuming we've already submitted, but I hope to find out. That's a good way to communicate kind of what we're looking for skills-wise and whatever, so as a business. Back to the internship, we'd like to mention we have internships, use them a little bit, but that training curve for some of our specialty areas and the drain on some of the more seasoned people, we haven't figured that out yet. That's definitely something as an organization we have to figure out, but we're in the middle of some major efforts that are forcing us to delay on that. But I hear that from my managers saying, yeah, well, if I take on an intern, I'm gonna lose productivity for my senior folks. And that's just something that we just need to solve. We just haven't figured that out. And it might be a partnership between the universities and us to try and make sure that it'll work, because I do think that's a good feeder.
So, all right, good. Well, good discussion. How about a hand for our panel here? Does anybody have any questions for our members of our panel? I'll grab the microphone. As I come over to you, just tell me your name and what you do. And have.
I'm Lauren Perdio, and I am a portfolio manager at West Michelle, Rhode Island. I've had the opportunity to be an educator. I have been in many different roles in IT. And, you know, one of the things, I love the idea of going at the K-12. One of my observations as a parent has been that many of the teachers have no concept and they have no idea about how to introduce these kids to technology. They don't use it. They might not even know how to use the computers in their classroom. Are there things happening outside of the computer science departments to start to bring those younger K-12 educators?
Just like you or I, our faculty has been discussing different ways to teach within our School of Education. We were kind of surprised that Rhode Island itself does not have a state certification for computer science teachers at the K-12 level. And that's part of our problem is if there was a certification already in existence, we can map to it. So we're trying to work at it. And to be honest, I think 8 years is optimistic if you wanted to get something actually certified at that state level. But we've been really working at that. We've been trying to really push our minor students, our introductory to computer programming course. We really do emphasize that for our School of Secondary Ed. And we've actually seen an increase in the number of student teachers who have been taking that course. So we think there is some potential there.
All right. Does someone have a question for our industry people? Yes? No? Industry? Okay. Go ahead. Tell me your name and what do you do?
My name is Ian Oskell, and I'm professor at Rhode Island College, and I'm also a president of the Computer Science Teacher Association of Rhode Island. So my question to industry is, how valuable is a college degree for you? And when I talk about that, I have students who may have been in IT at one time, have unfortunately lost their jobs, and then find for some industries that they can't go anywhere, even though they have a great deal of training, they're kind of, they can't do anything unless they actually get their degree now. So I'm asking you that because I see that there are different pathways to this, and what do you see, what's currently happening?
All right. Let's, who wants to tackle it first? Peter.
For the entry-level positions that we had talked about, we're looking for a bachelor's degree. We hold to that pretty much, at least with a development position. It's not all positions in our department. But we also, equivalent experience. So if somebody was in IT before, you know, they left the industry, did something different, but have a lot of experience, we would definitely look at them as well because that's there. It's not a hard requirement. It's experience as well. So if they have equivalent experience, we actually have quite a few people in our department who began with an associate's degree back 20, 30 years ago. And so they don't have a bachelor's degree, but they're actually some great managers who are in that camp. So yeah, we look at all of the experience that somebody might have.
Chris?
Yeah, I'd say that I think my answer is similar. I think for the non-entry level, a degree or formal educational background is relatively unimportant because the primary thing that I look at is experience. And so what have they done? And, you know, especially if they have some experience, they're gonna stand or fall on that, not on an educational degree. At the entry level, I'd say it is more important. We use it as a signal, as a differentiator. And ironically, perhaps, the area of the degree actually isn't as important as you might think. I mean, when I look at a CS grad, you know, I'm glad that they're gonna have a certain canon of educational experience, you know, but if somebody has, I mean, we have like a couple of our folks have chemical engineering degrees, they just wanna make a switch into computer science because they took some computer science classes and they like programming. Okay, that's fine. We can backfill what you missed, you know, in an educational program But, you know, if you actually, you know, went through and you learned, you might actually be able to think clearly. And that's what matters. You know, a law degree, that's great. Okay, you don't like doing law anymore, I don't blame you. So you want a program, fine. But you learn to think clearly, make arguments. So it's not so much there's a certain level of benefit that comes from the CS degree itself, but there's a substantial benefit that just comes from that educational experience and what it correlates with in terms of maturity.
All right. Will you take old, washed-up journalists? Looking to make a switch. We're getting close to time here, so I'm guessing that our panelists are not going to be running off. I don't know, maybe have a few minutes if people want to raise some questions. Do we have time for one more? One more. So someone with a burning question, and this woman in the back has been waving at me, and tell me your name first of all. What do you do?
My name is Susan Allstrom. I'm the Director of Development at the Academy for Career Exploration, and I don't have a question so much as a comment. Again, I want to emphasize some of the things we've been talking about this morning. The Academy for Career Exploration is a public charter school, and we serve a demographic that is in need of the tools and education that we're providing. But I want
nobody
to...
Nobody said anything about an ad.
No. What I want to really advocate is what is happening here today and how critical it is in order to make the change that will see the results that are needed in industry, et cetera. And we have worked with the industry partners, the educational partners, and that collaboration is so critical, and we are so grateful to people like Bridge Technical Talent and Amiga, in trying to identify ways to continue the internships, build those essential skills into curriculum as well as get IT. My point is that, as Janet stated, it is so critical that business get involved and advocate for changes that need to happen, including how we hire teachers, how we credential teachers who are teaching in our public school system. We have a highly qualified teacher that we've been trying to hire that we have actively engaged, who's an industry professional who has so much to offer to teach these skills and engage our students. But we need to make changes on the state level to our educational system that will allow us to hire those teachers with the skills that can educate for computer science. So if I had a question, if I need a question,
I'm just going to say that you didn't have a question, but you're on the committee. You're on the
committee. We invite you all to continue to stay actively involved, and thank you for all that you're doing here.
All right. Well, thanks, everybody. This was great. I hope everybody got something out of it.
And thanks so much to you. Round of applause for Steve, too. I just wanted to thank the panel personally for giving your time over the last few weeks to prepare for this and come in today and get this conversation started. It was very, very informative and a great first step in this endeavor. So thank you so much. I also want to get some Bridge swag for you, so make sure you don't leave rid of that. Did you have some stuff?
Yeah, just a couple of housekeeping / closing remarks. You all have print copies of the report. You can go to tech-collective.org, bridge-talent.com to download it. Or if you want more hard copies, I don't think we have too many left today, but let us know, we'll get them to you. That's not a problem. Go to TechRI's website and put in your information, because we need that. That's our compass going forward. So if you have any questions, Jen and Lee are always here to answer. A couple of other things going on here for the industry. One is, I think I'm speaking to the choir a little bit, but we have an IT and a bioscience industry overview presentation going on here on Wednesday at Tech Collective. So if you want to learn more about IT or bio, I think you guys are familiar all about it. But it's here, it's 8:30 to 10:30. Employers and educators, if you want to know about the workforce system programs, I think the Commerce RI are doing, the Governance Workforce Board is doing, the Real Jobs is doing to help employers and industry grow here in Rhode Island. There's going to be a presentation here on June 22nd from 8:30 to 10:30. So if you want to learn more about other incentives for you, I would highly encourage you to come here. That same night, we're having a GitHub workshop. So if you're a techie and want to know about GitHub, or just, you know, come out with a bunch of other people doing the same thing you are, it's going to be 5:30 to 7:30 on June 22nd. And last but not least, go right to the soft skills. We have effective communications workshops going on 6:28. It's 8:30 to 1 o'clock here at Tech Collective, or actually it's at Bryant University, your alma mater, or it's at the BBC. So we run this workshop several times. It's highly popular. If we only have a few spots, I think 5 or 6 spots left, but if you or any of your colleagues or teams need some effective communications training, this is the place to go. So any follow-up, all information on our website, you can contact Joe or I for anything about today, or if you're looking to get involved with some of the K-12, K-16 programs, we know where to check you. So thank you very much.
Get involved. If you're business, if you're hiring, make sure you check out TechIRI. And don't be afraid to get involved. Tech Life is putting together, at some point, we're going to try to build the speakers bureau, so people that want to get out there and get in the community, like some of the folks that are doing. You know, don't be afraid to contact Tech Life and go to your own K-12 system. You know, wherever you are, you're in East Providence, no matter where you go to your own school, and you can kind of evangelize about this, so that by the time they get to Chris's door, they will know about IT. Or wait till they get there. We want to prep them early, right?
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming.